المعالي القدر العظيم الجاه، وعلى آله وأصحابه وعلى من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. ثم أما بعد، praise be to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Lord of the heavens and the earth, and we ask him to send his peace, blessings and rest upon our master, the master of all of the prophets and messengers, Sayyiduna Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, upon his blessed household, his loyal companions, and all of those who followed after them with excellence up until the day of standing. Ameena, ameena, ameen. Thereafter, we praise Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for gathering us to recite the blessed words of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as reported and narrated by the great Imam Abu Abdullah Muhammad ibn Ismail ibn Ibrahim ibn al-Mughira ibn Bardizbah البخاري والجعفي مولاهم رضي الله عنه ونفعنا الله به وبكم في الدارين آمين. And the particular version that we will be reciting through is the abridgment of the great Imam Abu Muhammad Abdullah ibn Sa'd ibn Abi Jamrah al-Azdi رضي الله عنه, who is an Andalusian scholar who took from the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari رضي الله عنه 300 ahadith, and he separated these 300 into an abridgment of Sahih al-Bukhari. And after doing that, he mentioned that some of his students asked him to write a commentary on these 300 ahadith, so he did so. And what he mentions in his preface, in his introduction to the book, something very interesting concerning how the Sahaba radiallahu anhum would deal with the words of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and ahadith and narrating it. He says, وَأَمَّا أَئِمَّةُ الدِّينِ رَحِمَهُمُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى فَإِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا يَحْتَرِمُونَ الْحَدِيثَ أَعْظَمَ الْإِحْتِرَامِ حَتَّى أَنَّهُ كَانَ عِنْدَهُمْ مِثْلُ الْقُرْآنِ وَيَسْتَنْبِطُونَ مِنْ أَلْفَاظِهِ وَحُرُوفِهِ أَحْكَامًا وَأَيَّ أَحْكَامٍ. He said, the imams of this ummah, the leaders of this ummah, the scholars of this ummah would venerate and honor the words of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, an enormous veneration and honoring. It was as if they were dealing with the Quran itself. It was as if they were dealing with the Quran itself. And they would derive from the words of the hadith rulings and understandings, يَبْدُونَ قَوَاعِدَ مَذَاهِبِهِمْ, upon which they would base opinions of their particular schools of understanding. And then he gives an example and he says, وَأَمَّا إِحْتِرَامُهُمْ الْحَدِيثِ, as for their veneration and respect and honor for hadith, فَمِثْلُ ذَلِكَ مَا حُكِيَ عَنْ الإمام مالك رضي الله عنه. And he said the likes of that is narrated from Imam Malik رضي الله عنه, who is known as Imam Dar al-Hijra, the Imam of the abode of migration. حين أتاه الخليفة إلى بيته. One day the Khalifa, the leader of the believing people, attended the house of Imam Malik and he knocked. فأبطأ عليه. He knocked the door and Imam Malik took his time. Took his time in replying and attending the door and opening the door. فَلَمَّا أَنْ خَرَجْ, and when Imam Malik arrived to the door, قَالَ الْخَلِيفَ, the Khalifa said to him, يَا مَالِكْ مَا زِلْتَ تَذِلُّ الْأُمَرَاءِ. The Khalifa said to him, oh Malik, are you still not venerating and giving respect and honor to the umara, to the leaders? Because he took his time opening the door. فَقَالَ لَا. Imam Malik said, no, that's not the case. It's not that this is an insult towards you or a disrespect towards you. He said, لَا. وَاللَّهِ إِلَّا أَنِّي سَمِعْتُكَ فَعْلِمْتُ أَنَّكَ لَمْ تَأْتِ إِلَّا لِتَسْأَلُنِي عَنِ الْحَدِيثِ. He said, Imam Malik replied to him, said, that's not the case. But rather, when I heard you come to the door, I knew that you have only come to ask me hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. You have only come to ask me hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. وَكُنْتُ عَلَىٰ غَيْرِ طَهَارَةٍ. When I heard you come, I knew you only came for hadith. And I was not in the state of wudu. I was not in the state of wudu. فَكَرِهْتُ أَنْ أَتَكَلَّمَ فِيهِ وَأَنَا عَلَىٰ غَيْرِ طَهَارَةٍ. And I disliked for myself to mention the hadith of Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam in a state that I am not in ablution, I am not in ritual purity. فَمَا عَلِمْتُ إِلَّا أَنْ تَوَضَّأْتُ. When I knew of your arrival, I went to perform wudu. وَخَرَجْتُ. And then I came out. So the reason for my delay was not that I was disrespecting you or not giving you your due honor, but rather I knew that you have only come to listen to hadith. And my state was that I was not upon ritual purity. So I went to perform wudu, and now I have come to open the door. So this time that took in between was only to perform wudu so that I do not narrate hadith على غير طهارة without طهارة. ومن ذلك أيضا ما حكي عنه أنه كان إذا طلبه الفقهاء لأن يدرسهم يسألهم ماذا تريدون. And another narration from Imam Malik that when the scholars of law, the scholars of fiqh, the scholars of jurisprudence would come to him, he would ask them, ماذا تريدون? What would you like? فَإِنْ أَخْبَرُوهُ أَنَّهُمْ يُرِيدُونَ الْفِقْهِ خَرَجَ عَلَى الْحَالَةِ. If they said to him, we want to listen to some fiqh, some law, some jurisprudence, he would come out in any state and speak to them. وَإِنْ أَخْبَرُوهُ أَنَّهُمْ يُرِيدُونَ الْحَدِيثِ تَطَهَّرَ وَتَطَيَّبَ وَلَبِسَ أَحْسَنَ ثيابه وتبخر بالمسك والعود ثم جلس للحديث. And if they said to him, if the fuqaha who came to his door said to him, we have come to listen to hadith, then he would take his time. Why? تطهر. Then he would come into ritual purity. وتطيب. He would use perfume. ولبس أحسن ثيابه. And he would put on the best of his clothing. وتبخر بالمسك. And then he would burn عود, and he would burn incense والعود. ثم جلس للحديث. And then he would sit to deliver hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. ومثل هذا عنه كثير. And examples of this from Imam Malik are plenty. فلما كان شأنه التعظيم سمي أمير المؤمنين في الحديث. And it was because of this veneration, this honor, this respect, this dignifying of hadith of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. It was for all of these reasons that he was known as Amirul Mu'mineen fil Hadith, leader of the believing people in hadith. It's also narrated that Imam Malik radiallahu anhu was in the marketplace and someone stopped him. Said, Imam, irwi li al-hadith, narrate to me hadith. And Imam Malik radiallahu anhu said, this man should be lashed 80 times. He said, how dare you dishonor hadith of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam and ask for it to be narrated in the worst of places? The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, خير بقاع الأرض المساجد وشرب بقاعها الأسواق. The best of places are the masajid, places of sajda, the houses of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the worst of places are the marketplaces. He said, how dare you ask for the hadith of the best of creation, salawatullahi wa salamu alayhi, to be narrated in the marketplace where people shout, where people raise their voices, where people cheat, where people lose their religion in the marketplaces. And the likes of this is also narrated from Imam al-Bukhari radiallahu anhu. as was mentioned in the previous lesson, that he said, there isn't a single hadith in my sahih, in my compendium of sahih, that I did not perform wudu before it and pray two rak'at for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then I inserted the hadith into my compendium of sahih. It was this type of honor for the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that raised those people. I heard of a scholar of hadith who was sitting with his students studying Sahih al-Bukhari. And the copy of Sahih al-Bukhari they had was a very old copy. And some of its footnotes were written at the upper margin. Some of its footnotes were written at the upper margin because the bottom margin had been filled. But the notes that were written at the upper margin, they could only be read if the book was turned around. If the book was turned around. The student of this teacher, he said that one day our teacher wanted to read a note which is on the upper margin, but he needed to turn the book around. But we were surprised that instead of turning the book around, he stood up and he came to the other end of the book and he read the note from the upper margin from the other end, and then he came back. We asked him and we said, teacher, wouldn't it have been easier if we turned the book for you and you recited the note of the upper margin from where you were? And he said, who am I that the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam be turned for me? The type of veneration, honor and respect and dignifying state that the Salaf radiallahu anhum were upon in honoring the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. They say Sayyidina Abdullah ibn Mas'ud radiallahu anhu, when he would narrate and when he would mention the name of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his face would turn pale. And they asked him, why is this the state? And he said, I know very well who I am narrating from. They knew who the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam was. He said, I know very well who I am narrating from. They knew the rank of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam in the court of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then the Imam Ibn Abi Jamrah Al-Andalusi Al-Azdi radiyallahu anhu, he says, Alhamdulillahi haqqa hamdi. We praise Allah, the due praiser. Wa salatu wa salamu ala Sayyidina Muhammadin al-khirati min khalqi. And salutations and peace upon our Master Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, al-khirati min khalqi, the best from amongst his creation. وعلى الصحابة السادة المختارين لصحبته. And upon his companions, those masters who were chosen for his company. وبعد. Now the scholars have said that when we see the word صحابة mentioned, without the word آل, without the word family, then this means that the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam have been included amongst the Sahaba, and they have not been differentiated. But what's the asl? What's the origin? To mention the al or to mention the ashab? The asl, the origin is to mention the al, the family of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. How do we know this? Because when the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam taught the Sahaba As-salawat al-Ibrahimiyya, how did he teach them? He said, say, Allahumma salli ala Muhammadin wa ala Ali Muhammadin. And there was no mention of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu. So the Sahaba, they are mentioned taba'an lil-al. They are mentioned in following up after the family of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. So when the Sahaba mentioned all alone and there is no mention of the Ahlul Bayt, then this means that the scholar has chosen to bring together and merge both the Sahaba and the Ahlul Bayt. Is that clear? وبعد, and thereafter, فلما كان الحديث وحفظه من أقرب الوسائل إلى الله عز وجل بمقتضى الآثار في ذلك. He said, since hadith and its memorization is from the closest of means in reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Hadith and its memorization is from the closest of means in reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala بِمُقْتَضَى الْآثَارِ فِي ذَلِكَ, and that has been indicated by narrations and tradition. فَمِنْهَا, and from amongst those narrations and traditions is قَوْلُهُ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ, his statement, may peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. مَنْ أَدَّى إِلَىٰ أُمَّتِي حَدِيثًا وَاحِدًا يُقِيمُ بِهِ سُنَّةً أَوْ يَرُدُّ بِهِ بِدْعَةً فَلَهُ الْجَنَّةِ. From that is the statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he who delivers to my ummah a single hadith by which a sunnah is established and a bid'ah is wardened off, falahu al-jannah, for that person is paradise. For that person is paradise. Therefore, one of the closest أقرب الوسائل, the closest means of reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the gardens of paradise is what? الحديث وحفظه. To study hadith and to memorize hadith and to deliver hadith. ومنها قوله صلى الله عليه وسلم, and from that is his statement, may peace and blessings of Allah be upon him. من حفظ على أمتي حديثا واحدا كان له أجر أحد وسبعين نبيا صديقا. He who memorizes a single hadith for my ummah, he will have the reward of 71 truthful prophets. أحد وسبعين نبيا صديقا. 71 truthful prophets. And we know that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ulama'u ummati ka'anbiya'i bani Israel." The scholars of my ummah are like the prophets of Bani Israel. And you can know how they are like the prophets of Bani Israel by bearing and carrying the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Wal asaru fi dhalika kaseer. And he said, and narrations and ahadith concerning this matter, i.e. the matter that hadith and its memorization is from the closest of means in to reaching Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he said there are plenty of ahadith that mention that. وَرَأَيْتُ الْهِمَمَ قَدْ قَصُرَتْ عَنْ حِفْظِهَا مَعَ كَثْرَةِ كُتُبِهَا مِنْ أَجْلِ أَسَانِيدِهَا. He said, and I have seen in our times, and he said, I have seen in our times that people's motivation in memorizing hadith has become little, and people's motivations has eased. People's motivation has been lost in memorizing hadith. Even though there are enormous numbers of books of hadith, people have given up. And one of the reasons why they have given up, min ajli asanidiha, due to their long chains of narration. حَدَّثَنَا فُلَانٌ عَنْ فُلَانٍ عَنْ فُلَانٍ عَنْ فُلَانٍ, so-and-so narrated from so-and-so, so-and-so narrated from so-and-so. Because the asanid was so long, people gave up on memorizing hadith. فَرَأَيْتُ أَنْ أَخُذَ مِنْ أَصَحِّ كُتُبِهِ كِتَابًا أَخْتَسِرُ مِنْهُ أَحَادِيثِ بِحَسَبِ الْحَاجَةِ إِلَيْهَا. So he said, I took the initiative of abridging, summarizing a book of hadith and putting together those ahadith that people are in need of most. Those ahadith that people are in need of most. This is from the intelligence of a scholar. This is from the intelligence of a scholar that he delivers to the people that which they need. And this is from the way of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. One Sahabi came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam and he said, Messenger of Allah, we travel in the sea and the ocean. And he wanted to know about the water of the ocean. Can they perform wudu with it? Is it pure? So he asked about the water of the sea and the ocean. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam replied and he said, الطَّهُورُ مَعُهُ الْحِلُّ مَيْتَتُ The Prophet ﷺ said to him, The water of the ocean and sea is all pure. And then the Prophet extended and said something else. He said, الطَّهُورُ مَيْتَتُ And the fish that you take out of it are halal for you. The food that you take out of it is halal for you. But the Sahabi never asked about that. Why did the Prophet ﷺ mention that to him? The scholars have said, this is uslub al-hakim. This is the style of a wise man. This is the style of a wise man that he sees in his questioner, in the one who is addressing what the questioner needs, and he answers in accordance to that. So Imam Ibn Abi Jamrah, he said, I have summarized from the thousands of ahadith that Imam al-Bukhari placed in his encyclopedia, those ahadith that people need the most in their daily lives. In their daily lives. وَأَخْتَصِرُ أَسَانِيدَهَا مَا عَدَى رَاوِ الْحَدِيثِ And he said, I put aside the asanid, the chains of narration, except the narrator of hadith, i.e. the companion who narrates it directly from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. فَلَا بُدَّ مِنْ For that's necessary. فَيَسْهُلَ حِفْظُهَا And then he gives reasons. Why did he do that? Why did he pull the asanid aside? When we know that asanid are extremely important. How important are they? Ask Imam Ibn al-Mubarak radiallahu anhu, who said, الْإِسْنَادُ خِصِّيصَةٌ لِلْأُمَّةِ الْمُحَمَّدِيَّةِ صلى الله على صاحبها وسلم Imam Ibn al-Mubarak said, Chains of narration are a speciality of this Muhammadan Ummah. لَوْلَاهُ لَقَالَ مَنْ شَاءَ مَا شَاءَ And if it wasn't for Asanid, then anyone would have said anything. Then anyone would have said anything. But we have Asanid, chains of narration, to verify what anyone says, to find out who they heard it from, to find out who they heard it from, right the way back, to the asal, to the manba, to the origin of that narration. So he said, فَيَسْهُلَ حِفْظُهَا So therefore, I have hope that memorizing this abridgment and this summary of Sahih al-Bukhari will become easy for people. وَتَكْسُرُ الْفَائِدَةُ فِيهَا إِنْ شَاءَ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى And its benefit will become plenty. Its benefit will become plenty. فوقع لي أن يكون كتاب البخاري لكونه من أصحها ولكونه رحمه الله تعالى كان من الصالحين وكان مجاب الدعوة He said, then it struck me that I should choose the book of Imam al-Bukhari رضي الله عنه to summarize. Why? For a number of reasons. لكونه من أصحها The first reason is because his compendium, his encyclopedia of hadith is from the most authenticated ahadith that can be found upon the face of the earth. Imam al-Nawawi radiallahu anhu, after narrating the first hadith in his Arba'een, what does he say? رواه الإمامان البخاري ومسلم This hadith has been narrated by the two great imams, al-Bukhari and Muslim. In their works of hadith, which are the most authentic books after the book of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, after the Qur'an al-Kareem, the most authentic of books. And Imam al-Juwayni radiallahu anhu, he said that if anyone takes an oath and says, that divorce be to my wife, if everything that Imam al-Bukhari in his Sahih as a Musnad narration, if everything that he narrated as a Sahih and a Musnad narration is not Sahih, then divorce be to my wife. Imam al-Juwayni said, If anyone takes a qasam like this, no divorce will occur between him and his wife. Why? Because everything that is musnad and sahih in the sahih of Imam Bukhari is authenticated to such a level that divorce won't occur. So the a'imma, the imams of this ummah, had so much confidence in the work of Imam al-Bukhari that even if some of them said this, they knew that divorce won't occur. Why? Because everything that is in the sahih and is musnad in Imam al-Bukhari sahih is sahih. And remember, there's a difference between musnad and everything that's in the sahih of Imam al-Bukhari. Because Imam al-Bukhari also narrates mu'allaqan, and he does not claim that the mu'allaqat of sahih al-Bukhari are sahih. He doesn't claim that. He only claims the musnadat of sahih al-Bukhari are sahih. What's the difference between a mu'allaq and a musnad? A musnad hadith goes all the way back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. A mu'allaq narration stops at a companion. A mu'allaq narration stops at a companion and doesn't go all the way back to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And mostly when Imam al-Bukhari narrates mu'allaqat, he narrates them in the titles of the chapters of the abwab. In the titles of the chapters of the abwab, there will be mu'allaqat. And those mu'allaqat, Imam al-Bukhari does not claim for them as-sihha, for them to be authenticated the way the musnad ahadith are authentic. Is that clear? This is why the title of his sahih is what? Al-Jami'u al-Musnadu al-Muttasil. Al-Jami'u al-Sahih al-Musnadu al-Muttasil min ayyami Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam wa sunanih. There are variations of the title of his compodium. This is one of them. That it is a compodium of Sahih Musnad Ahadith concerning the days of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and his blessed Sunan. So he said the first reason for choosing the Sahih of Imam al-Bukhari is because it's the most authentic of books of hadith. In Damascus, we were with a scholar of hadith, Sheikh Riyad al-Khiraqi. He's a young scholar of hadith. And a student asked him and said, "Teacher, what books do you advise us to read concerning fabricated narrations, which are known as mawdu'at or mawdu' narrations? What books do you advise us to read concerning mawdu' narrations?" And the Shaykh said to him, "You have sufficiency in that which is sahih. You have sufficiency in that which is sahih." The student was asking, there was a reason why the student was asking. The reason why the student was asking was, he was asking, what books can we read in which all of the fabricated statements are mentioned, so that when we read books of hadith, we can differentiate and we can recognize. And the Shaykh said, "Don't use this method of recognizing. Don't use this method of recognizing. Use a different method. Read everything that is sahih so that you know what the fabricated are. Read the sahih and then you will be able to know what the fabricated are." How will you be able to know? The scholars of hadith used to say that if anyone recites a hadith to us, whether we have heard that or not, by first hearing, our ears are able to tell whether this is a true statement of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam or not. The scholars were asked, "But how do you know that?" And they would reply in this manner, that if you go into a jewelry shop, if you go into a jewelry shop and you give some jewelry to the goldsmith, he will touch it and say, "This is pure or it's mixed." How does he know? The texture of his hand can tell through experience. And the scholars of hadith used to say, when we hear the words of the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, they are enwrapped in a light They are enwrapped in the light of prophecy with which they came out of the blessed mouth of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If we sense that blessing, those blessings of his blessed mouth sallallahu alaihi wasallam, we know this is a hadith. And if we don't sense that, we know this is a fabricated statement. Is that clear? So the best way of recognizing is to read everything that is sahih, and then you know what's in the opposite. So the first reason why he chose Sahih al-Bukhari, because min asahhi kutubi, it's from the most authentic books of hadith. And then he said, وَلِكَوْنِهِ رَحِمَهُ اللَّهُ تَعَالَى كَانَ مِنَ الصَّالِحِينَ. And the other reason is because he, Imam al-Bukhari, was from the righteous and was from the pious. An indication to what? That scholars would give priority to books of those scholars who are at high levels of righteousness. Who are at high levels of righteousness, in hope that the blessings of their righteousness will come into the reader of that particular book. وَكَانَ مُجَابَ الدَّعْوَةِ. And Imam al-Bukhari was also a person who people had experienced that his du'as were always accepted. People had experienced that his du'as were always accepted. وَدَعَى لِقَارِئِهِ. And he prayed for the one who recites Sahih al-Bukhari. Therefore, this gives a greater encouragement to the readers of Sahih al-Bukhari to read it, because Imam al-Bukhari made du'a for everyone who reads his Bukhari, and his du'a was experienced to be always accepted. وَقَدْ قَالَ لِمَنْ لَقِيْتُهُ مِنَ الْقُضَاةِ الَّذِينَ كَانَتْ لَهُمُ الْمَعْرِفَةُ وَالْرِحْلَةُ عَمَّنْ لَقِيَ مِنَ السَّادَةِ الْمُقِرِّ لَهُمْ بِالْفَضْلِ. And Imam ibn Abi Jamrah, he said, from amongst the scholars who I met, there were those who narrated to me and said, إِنَّ كِتَابَهُ مَا قُرِئَ فِي وَقْتِ شِدَّةٍ إِلَّا فُرِّجَتْ. They said to me that the book of Bukhari is not recited at times of hardship, except that those hardships are eased. And when we were in Damascus, in a masjid, in an old masjid in Damascus known as Jami' al-Tawbah, once a month, they would have a khatam of Sahih al-Bukhari. You know the way we have a khatam of the Quran al-Kareem? They would have a khatam of Sahih al-Bukhari, and they had divided up the book of Imam al-Bukhari into small portions. And a large gathering of people would gather, and everyone is given one portion, and they recite it all out in one gathering. Why? For this reason. مَا قُرِئَ فِي وَقْتِ شِدَّةٍ إِلَّا فُرِّجَتْ وَلَا رُكِبَ بِهِ فِي مَرْكَبٍ فَغَرِقَتْ قَطْ. And never was it ever carried upon a ship that ship would never sink. That ship would never sink. فَرَغِبْتُ مَعَ بَرَكَةِ الْحَدِيثِ فِي تِلْكَ الْبَرَكَاتِ. So Imam ibn Abi Jamrah, he said, I was encouraged and turned towards all of the blessings of hadith and these extra blessings from the Imam. لِمَا فِي الْقُلُوبِ مِنَ الصَّدَى. And then he speaks in humbleness about himself, that because my heart is so rusty, I need all of these extra blessings. فَلَعَلَّهُ بِفَضْلِ اللَّهِ أَنْ يَكْشِفَ عَمَاهَا. And perhaps with the mercy of Allah, the blindness of my heart will be uncovered. وَيُفَرِّجَ عَنْهَا شَدَائِدَ الْأَهْوَى. And perhaps with the blessings of it, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will relieve me from the most severe of desires that lie in my heart. أَلَّتِي تَرَاكَمَتْ عَلِيهَا. Those that have gathered upon my heart. وَلَعَلَّ بِحَمْلِ تِلْكَ الْأَحَادِيثِ الْجَلِيلَةِ تُعْفَى مِنَ الْغَرَطِ فِي بُحُورِ الْبِدَعِ وَالْآثَامِ. And perhaps by carrying these great ahadith, we will be saved from drowning in the oceans of innovation, bid'ah, and atham, sins. So when we carry hadith, we carry goodness. And this goodness will keep us away from bad and evil and illness. فَلَمَّا كَمُلَتْ بِحَسَبِ مَا وَفَّقَ اللَّهُ إِلَيْهِ. And when I complete the gatherings of these 300 or so ahadith, فَإِذَا هِيَ ثَلَاثُ مِئَةِ حَدِيثٍ غَيْرَ بِضْعٍ. And they were around 300 hadith. فَكَانَ أَوَّلُهَا. And the first of these hadith that I gathered, كَيْفَ كَانَ بَدْءُ الْوَحْيِ لِرَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ. How did revelation begin for the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wasallam? وآخرها, and the last of ahadith that I gathered was دخول أهل الجنة الجنة وإنعام الله عليهم بدوام رضاه فيها. So the first hadith that he placed was the hadith concerning the beginning of revelation. And the last hadith that he placed was concerning the people of paradise entering into paradise and the continuous favor of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala upon them in the gardens of paradise. He said, when I saw that my first hadith and my last hadith, I built a connection between the two and I named it جَمْعُ النِّهَايَةِ فِي بَدْءِ الْخَيْرِ وَالْغَايَةِ. I named it جَمْعُ النِّهَايَةِ, the gathering the end. فِي بَدْءِ الْخَيْرِ وَالْغَايَةِ, in the beginning of goodness and its end. The beginning of goodness will characterize anything. I narrated one hadith after the other, one hadith after the other. Why? رجاء أن يتمم الله لي ولكل من قرأه أو سمعه بدء الخير بغايته. In hope that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will complete for me, those who recite it and those who hear it, بدء الخير والغاية, goodness at the beginning and at the end. Goodness at the beginning and at the end. So it's as if Imam Ibn Abi Jamrah is saying, I gathered these 300 ahadith and I didn't chapterize them so that the one who starts to read it from the beginning reaches the end. The one who starts to read it from the beginning reaches the end and doesn't stop at a particular chapter and say, I've read this many chapters of the book. Is that clear? Is that clear? So this is a new style that Imam Ibn Abi Jamrah adopted. Whereas the style of Imam al-Bukhari of chapterizing is also a respected style, because that's the style of the Qur'an al-Kareem. The style of the Qur'an al-Kareem is what? That we have parts, we have surahs, we have ajza, we have hizbs, we have quarters, halves, three quarters. Why do we have that? So that people can divide up their reading. Whereas if people saw the entire Quran and thought I have to read it from beginning to end, their motivation will be less for that. But if they know they can divide it up, it will be easier for them to read through the Quran al-Kareem. Whereas because Imam Ibn Abi Jamrah was only gathering 300 or so ahadith, he didn't want to divide them up with chapterization. So that the one who begins from the beginning reaches the end. فَنَسْأَلُ اللَّهَ الْكَرِيمَ رَبَّ الْعَرْشِ الْعَظِيمِ. And then he completes his introduction by making a dua, asking Allah the most generous, Lord of the great throne, أَنْ يَجْعَلَهَا لِقُلُوبِنَا جَلَاءً, that he makes this work a relief for our hearts, and a purification and a light for our hearts. وَلِدَاءِ دِينِنَا شِفَاءً, and for the illnesses that we possess within our practice of the religion, a cure. The illnesses that we possess in the practice of our religion, a cure. بِمَنِّهِ, with his favor. لَا رَبَّ سِوَى, there is no Lord other than he, subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَصَلِّ اللَّهُ عَلَىٰ سَيِّدِنَا مُحَمَّدٍ, and peace and blessings be upon our master Muhammad, خاتم النبيين, the final and the seal and the last of all the prophets. والحمد لله رب العالمين, and praise be to Allah, Lord of the worlds. And then he begins with his first hadith and he says, وعن عائشة أم المؤمنين رضي الله عنها أنها قالت, on the authority of Sayyida Aisha, mother of the believing people, that she said, أول ما بدي به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من الوحي الرؤيا الصالحة في النوم, فكان لا يرى رؤيا إلا جاءت مثل فلق الصبح, ثم حبب إليه الخلاء, وكان يخلو بغار حراء فيتحنث فيه, وهو التعبد, الليالي ذوات العدد, قبل أن ينزع إلى أهله ويتزود لذلك,
ثم يرجع إلى خديجة فيتزود لمثلها حتى جاءه الحق وهو في غار حراء فجاءه الملك فقال اقرأ قال ما أنا بقارئ قال فأخذني فغطني حتى بلغ مني الجهد ثم أرسلني فقال اقرأ فقلت ما أنا بقارئ فأخذني فغطني الثانية حتى بلغ مني الجهد ثم أرسلني فقال اقرأ فقلت ما أنا بقارئ فأخذني فغطني الثالثة ثم أرسلني فقال اقرأ باسم ربك الذي خلق خلق الإنسان من علق اقرأ وربك الأكرم فرجع بها رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يرجف فؤاده فدخل على خديجة بنت خويلد فقال زملوني زملوني فزملوه حتى ذهب عنه الروح فقال لخديجة وأخبرها الخبر لقد خشيت على نفسي فقالت له خديجة كلا والله لا يخزيك الله أبدا إنك لتسر الرحم وتحمل الكل وتكسب المعدوم وتقري الضيف وتعين على نوائب الحق فانطلقت به خديجة حتى أتت به ورقة بن نوفل بن أسد بن عبد العزى بن عم خديجة وكان امرأة تنصر في الجاهلية وكان يكتب الكتاب العبراني فيكتب من الإنجيل بالعبرانية ما شاء الله أن يكتب وكان شيخا كبيرا قد عمي فقالت له خديجة يا ابن عم اسمع من ابن أخيك فقال له ورقة يا ابن أخي ماذا ترى فأخبره رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم خبر ما رأى فقال له ورقة هذا الناموس الذي نزل الله على موسى يا ليتني فيها جزعا ليتني أكون حيا إذ يخرجك قومك فقال رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم أو مخرجيهم قال نعم لم يأتي رجل قط بمثل ما جئت به إلا أودية وإن يدركني يومك أنصرك نصرا مؤزرا ثم لم ينشب ورقة أن توفي وفتر الوحي قال ابن شهاب أخبرني أبو سلمة بن عبد الرحمن أن جابر بن عبد الله الأنصاري قال وهو يحدث عن فترة الوحي فقال في حديثه بين أنا أمشي إذ سمعت صوتا من السماء فرفعت بصري فإذا الملك الذي جاءني بحراء جالس على كرسي بين السماء والأرض فرعبت منه فرجعت فقلت دثروني دثروني فأنزل الله عز وجل يا أيها المدثر قم فأنذر وربك فكبر وثيابك فطهر والرجز فاهجر فحمي الوحي وتتابع. That was the hadith that inshallah we will translate today and continue with its commentary in the next session inshallah ta'ala. Sayyida Aisha, mother of the believing people, and these subtleties are important to notice. The Ibn Abi Jamra's book of hadith starts with a female narrator. People in the world now speak about women's rights, whereas we don't need to speak about women's rights. Women were given by Islam and by the Prophet of Islam sallallahu alaihi wasallam honor that had not been seen before or after, had never been seen before upon the face of the earth and never has been seen till this day. Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha, as the scholars of hadith mention, is one of the top six narrators of hadith from the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. If you gather all of the Sahaba and we make a list of the top six, Sayyida Aisha is from amongst them. Not only that, Sayyida Aisha was a very intelligent narrator of hadith, even at a very young, tender age. Imam Badruddin al-Zarkashi radiallahu anhu has a very short work, but a very intense work concerning Sayyida Aisha. It's called Can anyone remember its name? The final portion of the title is لِمَا أَدْرَكَتْهُ عَائِشَةُ عَلَى الصَّحَابَةِ لِمَا أَدْرَكَتْهُ عَائِشَةُ عَلَى الصَّحَابَةِ
It's a short work concerning the critical analysis of Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha concerning the narration of hadith by the rest of the Sahaba. What does that mean? Nowadays we have in universities critical analysis of essays, of works, of journals, of books. Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha was not a person who narrated hadith and let everyone narrate as they wished. No. She used to grab the Sahaba. Why? There were times when Sayyida Aisha was sitting in her hujra, in her room, and she would hear everything the Prophet ﷺ narrates in the masjid. As we are sitting, the Sahaba would sit with the Prophet ﷺ. But sometimes people would turn up late, and they would only hear half a statement. And when they would sit to narrate, they would only narrate half a statement. And Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha would be critical of these narrations that were only narrated partially and not in their full. So there were so many times when she caught Sahaba narrating partial wordings of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that gave incomplete meanings, and she would grab them and say, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said this, this and this before what you mentioned. And then the Sahaba radiallahu anhu would rectify their narrations and complete their narrations because of the critical analysis of Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam praised her and said, خُذُوا هَذَا الدِّينَ عَنْ هَذِهِ الْحُمَيْرَةِ. Take this religion from this red one. From this red one. I.e. Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha. So our mother, Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha, said, أول ما بدي به رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم من الوحي الرؤيا الصالحة في النوم. The initial revelation which came to the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم was through true dreams. Was through true dreams. فكان لا يرى رؤيا إلا جاءت مثل فلق الصبح. So he would not see a dream except that it would come true like the breaking of dawn. I.e. like the disappearance of darkness and the appearance of light. When we see the sky at Fajr time, exactly at the time when Fajr enters, it's pitch black and we have a sudden breaking of light. Sayyida Aisha said, this is how the dreams of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam would come true. ثُمَّ حُبِّبَ إِلَيْهِ الْخَلَاءِ. After these dreams that came to the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, seclusion, and the grandfather of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to also go to the cave of Hira and worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And those who have visited the cave of Hira, they see the distance between the Haram and the cave of Hira. And the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to walk out all of that distance and all that height to keep away from everyone and to concentrate and focus upon worship. And in all of this are indications for all of us that there must be times in our lives that we move away from everyone and everything. We switch off. Right? Nowadays we don't even switch off in the masjid. We're standing in salah and our Facebooks are going ding ding. Our messaging is going ding ding. We need to switch off and connect somewhere else. This is what the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam used to do in the cave of Hira. فَيَتَحَنَّثُ فِيهِ. And he would make a tahannuth. And then she explains herself what tahannuth is. And she said, وَهُوَ التَّعَبُّدْ. And that's worship. اللَّيَالِ ذَوَاتِ الْعَدَدْ. Endless nights. Night after night after night. قَبْلَ أَنْ يَنْزِعَ إِلَىٰ أَهْلِهِ. Before returning to his family. وَيَتَزَوَّدَ لِذَلِكَ. And then he would take with him that which would suffice him for another few nights. And then he would go back to the mountain. ثُمَّ يَرْجِعُ إِلَىٰ خَدِيجَةَ فَيَتَزَوَّدُ لِمِثْلِهَا. Then he would return after a few nights to Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha and take more provisions for another few nights, and then he would go out again. In that there is another indication that a person of worship must have his provision with him. You don't sit and worship and say, it'll come to me. You go and fetch it. You go and get it yourself.
Allah said, وَتَزَوَّدُ and prepare your luggage, prepare your provision. فَإِنَّ خَيْرَ الزَّادِ التَّقْوَى. And then Allah said, the best of provision and the best of luggage is piety and righteousness and fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. حَتَّى جَاءَهُ الْحَقِّ until the truth came to him. وَهُوَ فِي غَارِ حِرَى whilst he was in the cave of Hira. فَجَاءَهُ الْمَلَكُ and the angel came to him. فَقَالْ and he said to him, اقرأ, read. And the Prophet replied, مَا أَنَا بِقَارِئِ I'm not a reciter. قَالَ فَأَخَذَنِي فَغَطَّنِي حَتَّى بَلَغَ مِنِّي الْجَهْدِ The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the angel took me and he embraced me and he hugged me so strong that he reached al-jahd. He reached the end of me such that I felt my soul would leave. He squeezed me so much. ثُمَّ أَرْسَلَنِي Then he released me. فَقَالَ And he said, اقرأ, read. فَقُلْتُ مَا أَنَا بِقَارِئِ I'm not a reader. فَأَخَذَنِي فَغَطَّنِي الثَّانِيَةِ Then he took me, he grabbed me, he embraced me, and he hugged me, and he squeezed me. حَتَّى بَلَغَ مِنِّي الْجَهْدِ Until he reached my end. ثُمَّ أَرْسَلَنِي Then he released me. فَقَالَ اقْرَأْ And then he said, read. فَقُلْتُ مَا أَنَا بِقَارِئِ I'm not a reader. فَأَخَذَنِي فَغَطَّنِي الثَّالِثَةِ Then he took me a third time, and he squeezed me until he reached the end of me. ثُمَّ أَرْسَلَنِي Then he released me. فَقَالَ And after the third, he said, اقْرَأْ بِاسْمِ رَبِّكَ الَّذِي خَلَقْ Read in the name of your Lord who created. خَلَقَ الْإِنسَانَ مِنْ عَلَقْ Created man from a blood clot. اقْرَأْ وَرَبُّكَ الْأَكْرَمُ Read and your Lord is the most generous. فَرَجَعَ بِهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمُ يَرْجُفُ فُؤَادُهُ The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam took these verses and he came back home and his heart was trembling. Why was his heart trembling? Because of the might, majesty, gravity, weight of the Quran al-Kareem and revelation. His heart was trembling. And this is the description of the believing people in the Quran. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said, إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ Allah said the believing people are those. إِنَّمَا الْمُؤْمِنُونَ الَّذِينَ إِذَا ذُكِرَ اللَّهُ The believing people are those. When Allah is mentioned, وَجِلَتْ قُلُوبُهُمْ Their hearts begin to tremble. وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ And when His signs, His verses are recited to them, وَإِذَا تُلِيَتْ عَلَيْهِمْ آيَاتُهُ زَادَتْهُمْ إِيمَانًا They increase them in iman, in faith, in certitude, in yaqeen. وَعَلَىٰ رَبِّهِمْ يَتَوَكَّلُونَ And upon their Lord, they depend. The state of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was this, that his heart began to tremble after hearing the Quran. فَدَخَلَ عَلَىٰ خَدِيجَةَ بْنِ خُوَيْلِبِ He came back home to his wife, Sayyida Khadija رضي الله عنها, and he said, زَمِّلُونِي زَمِّلُونِي Cover me, cover me. فَزَمَّلُوهُ And they covered him. حَتَّى ذَهَبَ عَنْهُ الرَّوْعُ Up until this frightening state had relaxed and calmed. فَقَالَ لِخَدِيجَةَ And then he mentioned to Khadija, وَأَخْبَرَهَا الْخَبَرُ Informed her of what had happened. And he said, لَقَدْ خَشِيتُ عَلَىٰ نَفْسِي I feared for myself. I.e. when Jibreel alayhi salam was squeezing him. فَقَالَتْ لَهُ خَدِيجَةَ Sayyida Khadija رضي الله عنها She said to him, and notice, in the first hadith, the narrator is a woman, and in the hadith we have a woman. Is that clear? Sayyida Khadija رضي الله عنها She was the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم security in his house. In Makkah al-Mukarramah, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم had two securities. One out there in society, one at home. The security that he had out there in society was his uncle Abu Talib. So long as Abu Talib lived, no one was able to say anything to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And his security at home was Sayyida Khadija radiyallahu anha. In one narration it is mentioned that when the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam would return home, after hearing what he had to hear from the kuffar of Makkah, after seeing the tribulation and the torture that the Sahaba were going through, when he would return home to his blessed wife, our mother radiallahu anha, she would place her hand on the chest of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, giving him comfort and ease. Giving him comfort and ease. She said, "Kalla, nay, wallahi la yukhzik Allahu abada. I swear by Allah, Allah will not let you go to loss ever." Why? Why was she so confident that Allah will not let the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam go to loss? This confidence wasn't built instantly. It takes time to build this confidence. Because she had seen the attributes and the qualities of the beloved of Allah sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Innaka latasilur rahim, number one, is that you join and you connect with your family ties. And what type of family ties? Ar-Rahim. Ar-Rahim are those family members who have a womb connection with us. So for example, our parents, we have a womb relationship with them. Our uncles and aunts from both our parents' side, mother's side and father's side, we have a womb connection to them. Our children, we have a womb connection to them. Is that clear? So anyone whom we have a womb connection with are our rahim. She said, "Innaka latasilur rahim." You connect with your family, you connect your family ties, and you connect with those people who you have a womb relationship with. وَتَحْمِلُ الْكَلِّ. And you carry people's difficulties, people's hardships, you carry them for them. وَتُكْسِبُ الْمَعْدُومِ. And you give to those who have nothing. Al-ma'dum, the one who doesn't have anything. You give those who have nothing. وَتُقْرِ الضَّيْفِ. And you are hospitable to your guests. وَتُعِينُ عَلَى نَوَائِبِ الْحَقِّ. And you assist and give aid upon the difficulties of time and the difficulties that people go through. So Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha saw that someone who has all of these good qualities in them, Allah will not let them go to loss. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala loves these qualities and He will not let such a person go to loss. فَانْتَلَقَتْ بِهِ خَدِيجَةً. Then Khadija radiallahu anha took the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam حَتَّى أَتَتْ بِهِ, until they reach وَرَقَةً, the son of Nawfal, the son of Asad, the son of Abdul Uzza. Waraqa was the cousin of Sayyida Khadija radiallahu anha. وَكَانَ امْرَأً تَنَصَّرَ فِي الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ. And he was someone who had become a Christian in the time of Jahiliyyah. Now the Makkans, they were pagans, they were idol worshippers. For a Makkan to become a Christian was a big thing. He's become Ahlul Kitab, become someone who honors and respects and follows a prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Whereas the rest of the Makkans, they had become pagans. وَكَانَ يَكْتُبُ الْكِتَابَ الْعِبْرَانِيِّ. And he used to write in Hebrew. فَيَكْتُبُ مِنَ الْإِنْجِيلِ بِالْعِبْرَانِيَّةِ مَا شَاءَ اللَّهِ. And he used to write from the Injil in Hebrew much. وَكَانَ شَيْخًا كَبِيرًا. And he was an elderly man. قَدْ عَمِيَ. He had lost his sight due to old age. All of this has indications. Why did Sayyida Khadija take him to Waraqa? Number one, because that was her cousin. To show, to take him to someone that they knew. To have that confidence and ease. Number two, he was a man of knowledge. He was a man of book. And where do we see this in the Quran? In the story of Sulaiman alayhi salam. The story of Sulaiman alayhi salam when he wanted the throne to be bought. The story of Sulaiman alayhi salam when he wanted the throne to be bought. They asked so and so, they asked so and so. But who was it who bought it at the end? The one who had knowledge of the book. The one who had knowledge of the book, he's the one who said, قَبْلَ أَنْ يَعْتَدَّ إِلَيْكَ طَرْفُكَ. You'll have the throne before you, before your eye blinks. Which indicates what?
in quote. What did he say in the Quran Kareem? قَدْ جَاءَكُمْ مِنَ اللَّهِ نُورٌ وَكِتَابٌ مُبِينٌ. Surely has come to you from Allah a light and a clear book. A light and a clear book. And the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, I'm leaving behind you two things. مَا إِن تَمَسَّكْتُمْ بِهِمَا لَن تَضِلُّوا بَعْدِي. So long as you grab hold of them tightly, you will not go astray. كتاب الله وعترتي. The book of Allah and my family. And in other narrations, the book of Allah and my sunnah. So she took him to Waraqa, who is an elderly man. Who is an elderly man. Also indicating what? Wisdom. Indicating wisdom. Because young people can be over energetic and ecstatic and be like fireworks, right? Spark up in the sky, show a bit of flame and a bit of color, and then it's all dead. Whereas elderly people are more wise. They've experienced life. They've been through the stages of life that young people haven't gone through, and they won't be so explosive. So she took him to an elderly man. And one of our teachers, radiallahu anhu, used to say, when a scholar is young, his knowledge is old. When a scholar is old, his knowledge is young. What did he mean? He said, when a scholar is young, his knowledge is old. In that when a scholar is young, when he is younger of age, his knowledge is old in that he doesn't know or he doesn't yet have much experience in how to put it together and how to organize it and have it in the right way and manner. Whereas when the scholar reaches an old age, that's when his knowledge becomes young and prime, in that he knows exactly how to organize it due to the wisdom of age. Due to the wisdom of age. This is why Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for example, in the Quran al-Kareem, he speaks about the age of 40. What does he say? فَلَمَّا بَلَغَ أَشُدَّهُ وَبَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً قَالَ رَبِّ أَوْزِعْنِي. Allah says, when a person reaches his full strength, when a person reaches his full strength, and what's the age of full strength? وَبَلَغَ أَرْبَعِينَ سَنَةً. The age of 40 is the age of full strength. What happens then? That's when a person becomes humble and raises his hands and says, رَبِّ أَوْزِعْنِي أَنْ أَشْكُرَ نِعْمَتَكَ الَّتِي أَنْعَمْتَ عَلَيَّ وَعَلَىٰ وَالِدَيْهِ. Lord, allow me to thank you for your favors upon me, and allow me to thank my parents for the favors that they had over me. Why? Because by the age of 40, someone's become a father and maybe even a grandfather. That's when they'll realize the difficulties that their parents went through in bringing them up. So age matters. Is that clear? So she took him to an elderly man of wisdom. An elderly man of wisdom and knowledge of the book. These combinations are important. فَقَالَتْ لَهُ خَدِيجَةً. Sayyidah Khadija said to Waraqa, Ya ibn Am, O cousin, Isma min ibn akhika. Listen to your cousin. Listen to your cousin, i.e. the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. فَقَالَ لَهُ Waraqa. Waraqa said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Ya ibn akhi, cousin, ماذا ترى? What do you see? فَأَخْبَرَهُ رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ خَبَرَ مَا رَأَى. So the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam narrated to him exactly what happened and what he saw. فقال له ورقة. ورقة replied to him and said, هذا الناموس الذي نزل الله على موسى. This is the exact same message that Allah revealed to موسى عليه السلام. يا ليتني فيها جزعا. Only if I was a young man when Allah allows this to prevail. ليتني أكون حيا. Only if I have life till the time when your matter will prevail. إِذْ يُخْرِجُكَ قَوْمُكَ. When your people will make you flee. When your people will make you flee and leave out from your own city and your own land. And the Prophet ﷺ was surprised. And he said, أَوَ مُخْرِجِيَّهُمْ. Will they expel me? Will they make me flee from my city? from my land. Remember, the Prophet was 40 years of age. He had lived and grown up in Makkah. His children were married in Makkah. He had done business in Makkah. All of his life was in Makkah. He was surprised how these people who respected him, honored him, took him to be al-Sadiq al-Amin, will now expel him from that city. And Waraqa said, na'am, yes, they will expel you. لَمْ يَأْتِ رَجُلٌ قَطُ بِمِثْلِ مَا جِئْتَ بِهِ إِلَّا أُوْدِيَا. No man has ever come with that which you have been given, except that he was opposed, except that people stood against him. وَإِن يُدْرِكْنِي يَوْمُكْ أَنْصُرُكَ نَصْرًا مُؤَزَّرًا. And if I am still alive in the days when your matter prevails, then I shall help you and aid you and assist you the best I can. ثُمَّ لَمْ يَنْشَبْ وَرَقَةُ أَنْ تُوُفِّيَ وَفَتَغَ الْوَحِيِ. It wasn't too long later that Waraqa, this elderly man, he died and he died and wahi stopped. Revelation stopped. Now the scholars have a difference of opinion as to how long revelation stopped for. But there was a short period of time in which, after the initial stage of revelation, revelation stopped. And we'll come on to that later, inshallah. قال ابن شهاب. Ibn Shihab said. Who is Ibn Shihab? This is Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, radiyallahu anhu. This Ibn Shihab is the man who we need to celebrate and salute. And he deserves every praisal and every dua from us. Because if it wasn't for Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, we would not have hadith today. He was ordered by the Khalifa of his time to gather hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And some scholars say that he was the first person ever to gather hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, radiyallahu anhu. Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri, he said, وَأَخْبَرَنِي أَبُو سَلَمَةُ بْنُ عَبْدِ الرَّحْمَانِ. He said, Abu Salama ibn Abd al-Rahman informed me that the companion Jabir ibn Abdullah al-Ansari, radiyallahu anhu, said, وَهُوَ يُحَدِّثُ عَنْ فَتْرَةِ الْوَحِيِ. Whilst he was speaking about the lapsing of revelation. This is known as فَتْرَةُ الْوَحِيِ, the lapsing of revelation, the stopping and pausing of revelation. فَقَالَ فِي حَدِيثِهِ. Jabir ibn Abdullah said in his hadith, بَيْنَا أَنَا أَمْشِي إِذْ سَمِعْتُ صَوْتًا مِنَ السَّمَاءِ. Narrating from the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam that he said, whilst I was walking, I heard a voice from the heavens. فَرَفَعْتُ بَصَرِي. I raised my sight. فَإِذَا الْمَلَكَ الَّذِي جَاءَنِي بِحِرَى. I raised my sight and I saw the same angel who came to me at the cave of Hira in the sky. جَالِسٌ عَلَىٰ كُرْسِيٍ بَيْنِ السَّمَاءِ وَالْأَرْضِ. He was seated upon a chair, upon a throne which was between the heavens and the earth. فَرُعِبْتُ مِنْ. I was frightened of him. فَرَجَعْتُ. And I returned back home. فقلت, and I said, دثروني دثروني, cover me, cover me. فأنزل الله عز وجل. At that point, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed to me, يا أيها المدثر, O the one who is cloaked and covered. قم فأنذر, stand and warn. وربك فكبر, and your Lord, and magnify your Lord. وثيابك فطهر, and purify your clothing. وَالرُّجْزَ فَهْجُرْ, and keep away from filth and evil. فَحَمِيَ الْوَحْيُ وَتَتَابَعْ. That's after this revelation of يَا أَيُّهَا الْمُدَّثِّرْ, revelation became heated. حَمِيَ الْوَحْيُ, it became heated and continued. وَتَتَابَعْ. So this portion that Ibn Shihab al-Zuhri mentions, why did he mention this at the end of this hadith? To indicate that after the pausing and the lapsing of revelation, this is how it continued. This is how it restarted when the Prophet ﷺ was walking in the streets of Makkah and suddenly he heard a voice. He looked up and it was Jibreel alayhi salam, and then he returned back home, said to his wife, cover me, and that's when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed the initial verses of Surah Al-Muddathir. And after that, حَمِيُ الْوَحْيُ وَتَتَابَعْ. Revelation was heated after that and it continued. It didn't stop after that. Is that clear?
So that's the actual hadith concerning the beginning of revelation. By next week, inshallah, everyone should have memorized it. Who's going to memorize it? Ibn Abi Jamrah said, I only gathered 300 from thousands. And he said, the reason behind gathering them is so people can memorize them. Who wants to memorize the words of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam? Is that okay? So we'll have this memorized by next week. And in the next session, what we'll do is summarize the 72 or odd points that Ibn Abi Jamrah makes about this hadith. I picked up this book of hadith when I was in Syria in the year 2002, I think. How long ago was that? 11 years ago. I was in the house of a friend of mine, Sheikh Tanweer, and I saw this book in his house. And he said to me, it's an excellent book, go and pick it up. So I went to the marketplace and I bought it instantly. I came home, I was living alone then. I came home and I sat down and I began to read. I read this hadith, the first one, and then I read its commentary. Look at the pages. And I read, and I read, and I read, and I read. And when I reached the last point, he said, Al-Wajhul Hadi was Sab'un. Point number 71. I did this. I said, who was this Imam who derived 71 miraculous points? I was baffled by Ibn Abi Jamrah. I closed the book just to read his name again. Then I continued reading this book. And one day I was in a bookstore, which is known as Maktabatul Bayruti. It's owned by one of our teachers, Sheikh Mahmoud Al-Bayruti. I was in there. And my friend Sheikh Ridwan from Glasgow was also there. I said to him, have you seen this book? And I pointed at this book. I said, have you seen this book? Bahjatul Nufus by Ibn Abi Jamrah. And he stood there and he said, yes, it's one of the first books I ever bought. It's one of the first books I ever bought. I said to him, it's amazing. I was like really overwhelmed by the book. I said, it's an amazing book. He said to me, have you read the last portion of the book? I said, no, what is it about? He said, go home and check it. It was like a toy. You know, like a kid has a toy and someone tells them about a discovery that they haven't discovered. So I rushed back home and I picked up the second volume and I went right to the end of the book. Guess what it said? At the end of the book, Imam Ibn Abi Jamrah radiallahu anh writes a short epistle and a short work. What is he mentioning there? 70 dreams that he saw of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, verifying and confirming his commentary on this book of hadith. And those dreams, he mentions them in detail. 70 dreams in which the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam confirmed for him his commentary on every hadith that he wrote. And Hafiz ibn Hajar al-Asqalani radiallahu anhu, who is known as Amirul Mu'mineen fil Hadith, who wrote the enormous work Fathul Bari Sharh Sahih Bukhari, when he refers to Ibn Abi Jamrah, what does he say? Qala al-arifu billah. He refers to him and he says, the Gnostic and Knower of Allah said. The Gnostic and Knower of Allah said. And the Hafiz of Hadith, Sayyidi Abdul Aziz Ibn Siddiq al-Ghumari radiallahu anhu, used to constantly mention this, that Hafiz ibn Hajar used to relate to Ibn Abi Jamrah by calling him Al-Arifu Billah, the one who knew Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is a very blessed commentary. Inshallah, we'll try to summarize some of the points of the 71 points that he mentions in the next lesson. But how about we sit also and listen to each other recite the hadith in Arabic. Naeem's up for it with that big smile. Alhamdulillah Rabbil Alameen. وصلى الله على سيدنا محمد وآله وصحبه أجمعين سبحان ربك رب العزة عما يصفون وسلام على المرسلين والحمد لله رب العالمين.